I'm always interested in the perception of kids as to what's going on. I love to just ask kids questions and just see how they see things, you know. We've just lost so much of that childlike wonder and, you know, that assumption of what things mean before we add so much information to what we know. And sitting in my office this morning, and grandbaby number one is in there sitting on the arm of my chair while I'm working on the message. And she saw me. I kept looking up at the Bible, and she said, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm working on the message for today." She said, "Are you just typing what's on there?" And I said, "No." I said, "I'm typing stuff about what's on there." And she was like, "She said, why?" And I said, "Because that's what I do. That's kind of what I. That's why I come here. That's what I'm supposed to do." And I realized all of a sudden, it was like she has no idea what I do here. And so I wanted to know what she thought goes on in here after they go to her room. And so I asked her, and she said, I said, "What I do is kind of for all the adults what your teacher does when you go back to your kid church class." And she was astounded. She said, "I thought you guys just sat around and relaxed in there." Isn't that amazing? It's just inbred in us. We assume that nobody else is working as hard as we are. We assume that, okay, I'll do it. And everybody, y'all just sit down, sit back and relax. I'll take care of what needs to be done. It just tripped me up, man. I love it. Let's finish up 2 Corinthians today. What do you say? 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 11. That's where we're going to start. If I can find it. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 11. "I have become a fool in boasting. You have compelled me. For I ought to have been commended by you, for in nothing was I behind the most eminent apostles, though I am nothing. Truly the signs of an apostle were accomplished among you with all perseverance in signs and wonders and mighty deeds. For what is it in which you were inferior to other churches, except that I myself was not burdensome to you? Forgive me this wrong." We talked about this the last couple of weeks. They pushed Paul into a corner where he was trapped into speaking about himself, and he knew the whole time he wasn't comfortable with it and just sounded like he was bragging, like he was a big deal. And yet at the same time, in the back of his mind, he has this realization that these false teachers have come in and told his kids that you can't trust that guy. He's a little weak. He's got a big hooked nose and short, weak legs and bow-legged. And he's, look at all those scars all over him. He's just weak, you know. And he writes to you like a big man in these letters from afar. But when he's with you, he's just so kind and humble. That was supposed to be a good thing. And they're using that as an attack against him. And he says, "I should have been commended by you." He said, "You guys should have stuck up for me. When I was with you, I performed all of these signs and wonders like the Scripture said that I would, so that you would know that I was the real deal, that I was sharing the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you were so glad when I was there and you got saved and this church is there and it's growing and things are going great. And then here come these false teachers and they start talking against what I taught you and talking against me and my guys, and they're charging you for the privilege of running down your spiritual father. You should have stood up for me. But because you didn't, you compelled me to brag about myself. And I hated it. I've become a fool in boasting." He said, "I know that's worthless." He knows that's not the way to handle things. We can never try and use what is so great about us to attract others to Christ. And that's what he feels like they've trapped him into doing here. Like he's backing up his validity as a follower of Christ and a teacher and an evangelist based on his strength and power and ability. And he knows that's a bad idea. We've got to know that that's a bad idea. We can never want to attract others to Christ by explaining what a big deal we are. It has to be about Jesus. In the same way, we have to be careful of elevating people, other people, to some higher level of importance in the kingdom. You know, humility is godly and scriptural and the way we should proceed through life with all humility, knowing that every good gift we have came from God, from salvation on down the line to every blessing we've ever had. Yes, we don't take credit for any of that. But that can even be taken to an unhealthy level. And I see that sometimes, even in this church, where sometimes folks are enamored with how somebody else prays, or how somebody else is able to teach, or how somebody else is able to do this, and they can't. And so sometimes it's not even somebody actually boasting about themselves. Sometimes we do it for them, and they don't even want that. And we elevate them to some position. This is why when we get together and the elders and I pray over somebody, if you haven't experienced that, it's very strange. I'm sure the first time it happens, we all pray at the same time. We don't take turns. And that probably seems very odd to somebody the first time they go through that. Here's why we do it. We don't want you to think that anybody's prayer is more important or more powerful, that any of us have more access to God than anybody else. We don't have any more access to God than you do. We're not more important than you are. And so we all pray at the same time, not wanting you to be able to pick out what everybody is saying, so that you can't give us any of the credit. You can't single out a person and go, oh, it was what you prayed that made the difference. No, it was God that made the difference in you. It was your humility in coming and asking for prayer, that your faith in Him, that made the difference. We were just allowed to be vessels. Paul knows the truth, and he wants them to know the truth. The only important thing about him is the truth of Jesus, and the gospel was revealed to him, and he was given a chance to accept it. And he gave his life to Christ, and he was sent out by Jesus to minister. That's the only thing that actually matters about Paul, and he's very comfortable in that, and we have to be very comfortable in that, because guess what? That's a description of every true follower of Christ in this room today. Called, saved, sent. That's who we have to be. And amazing things will happen if we will just let Him send us, so long as we don't take any of the credit for it, so long as we point people directly to Him, so long as we speak the truth in love, which is all Paul wanted to do. He hates having to get so aggressive in the way that he's treating his kids. That's not who he wants to be. Verse 14. Now for the third time, I am ready to come to you, and I will not be burdensome to you, for I do not seek yours, but you. For the children ought not to lay up for the parents, but the parents for the children. And I will very gladly spend and be spent for your souls. Though the more abundantly I love you, the less I am loved. But be that as it may, I did not burden you. Nevertheless, being crafty, I caught you by cunning. Did I take advantage of you by any of those whom I sent to you? I urged Titus and sent our brother with him. Did Titus take advantage of you? Did we not walk in the same spirit? Did we not walk in the same steps? Again, do you think that we excuse ourselves to you? That means defend ourselves to you. We speak before God in Christ. But we do all things, beloved, for your edification. For I fear, lest when I come, I shall not find you such as I wish, and that I shall be found by you such as you do not wish. Lest there be contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, backbitings, whisperings, conceits, tumults. Lest when I come again, my God will humble me among you, and I shall mourn for many who have sinned before and have not repented of the uncleanness, fornication, and lewdness which they have practiced. Again, he just wants to let them know, guys, I'm not trying to get anything from you. I've never tried to get anything from you. I'm trying to get you as close to Jesus as I can, because that's all that matters. That's the only real blessing there is to be had. He saw himself as their provider, not as a taker from them, not to be supported by them, but to support them. That's the way we should minister to one another and to the lost, always. We can't allow the enemy to get involved and convince somebody that we're only showing them love because we want to get something back. That's why Scripture is so plain about especially ministering to those who you cannot expect anything back from. What does James say? Pure and undefiled religion is this: visit widows and orphans in their trouble. Go help those that there's no way that you're doing that to get something for yourself. There can be no mistaking that it's from God then. In Philippians chapter 2, it says, yes, Paul says, yes, and if I am poured out as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. And it's hard to love people sometimes. It costs you something. But it's an act of worship. And worship always costs us something. What did David say that time? He wanted to worship, and his loyal subject was there, and he said, hey, I'll give you everything that you need. Here, please take of my goods to honor God with your sacrifice and your offering. And David said, I will not sacrifice that which didn't cost me anything. There's no glory for God in that. If I take from you and offer that to God, that was your offering, not mine. And that's Paul's attitude here. He's like, man, I'm pouring myself out like a drink offering for your benefit, and I'm glad to do so. That's who I want to be. Even though you're not even loving me back, that's still who I have to be. That's how my conscience stays clear. Because it's not about what I can get back from you, not even the love and the respect that I am owed. I still pour myself out for you, my children, because I love you that much. In 2 Timothy, he says, for I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. I've fought the good fight. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. Man, I hope we can say that on our deathbed. Man. When the time of our passing to the other side is at hand, may we be able to have this clear a conscience before our Lord. To be able to be so excited about knowing we are about to see Him. We don't have anything in our mind. We're replaying everything. We don't have anything. Oh, I wish I hadn't said that. I wish I hadn't done that. I wish I hadn't acted that way. Paul's already dealt with all those things. He's repented of it and walked away from it. And laying there about to die, he's very close to the end there. He's like, man, I did all I could do. I poured myself out. I didn't do what I did here for gain. And yet, man, there's a gain coming because I'm about to be face to face with Jesus. He's going to hand me that crown of righteousness because I loved Him enough to give my life to Him and give of my life for others. He's going to hand me that crown. You know what? I'm going to take it, but I'm going to throw it right back at His feet. Just go, no, praise you, Jesus, for what you did through me. Thank you for the opportunity to pour myself out for others. It would have been great to have their love and respect because it would have been glory for you in that. But you know what? That's not why I did it. That's not why I needed to do it. He's already told us that it's the love of Christ that compels us. Because Jesus died and rose again. That's what compels us to move forward constantly, no matter what. I hope at that time of the end of our life that we can be able to say, I didn't just take advantage of your grace, Jesus, for my own benefit. I shared it with others. I didn't minister to others for gain, but only to be a blessing. I hope we can say, it doesn't bother me that I poured myself out, because I know I'm heading to your reward. See, verse 15 there is tough. I think we can all relate to the second half of the verse. And I hope we're moving towards the point where we can relate to the first half of the verse. Because the first half says, and I will very gladly spend and be spent for your souls. Now that's easy when people are loving you back. And they appreciate your efforts. They appreciate your love and your concern. That's glorious. You can commune with one another over that. And it's a beautiful thing. You can both praise God together. It's easy to sign up for that one. Paul says, I'm glad to do that, to be spent for your souls, though the more abundantly I love you, the less I am loved. That's tough. Ever feel like it's a waste of time to care about others? Like it's a waste of your time. Like they don't deserve the effort because they're not taking life nearly as seriously as you are. They're not taking their life nearly as seriously as you are taking their life. And it's tough. And it's easy to become self-righteous in that. Your concern for them can turn into judgment of them. And you rank them here and you here. And it's a very natural, fleshly thing to do. You have to pay attention and work against that all the time. This is just part of our lot in life. And all the relationships that we have with our kids, with our friends and our family, our coworkers, our husbands and our wives, sometimes we just have to do what we're supposed to do, and that has to be enough. We have to get our joy just from the fact that, hey, we're following Jesus. We're just following Jesus. If you're trying to minister to somebody else and they're snapping at you the whole time, they're fighting back, not only do they not appreciate it, man, they're like, you jerk. Paul would say, welcome to the club. I'd say you're in good company. Read the rest of the New Testament. Did a lot of people get saved? Yes. Did all of the 12 die because of their faith? Yep. Stoned, hung, crucified. Threw John in a pot of boiling oil, and it just didn't kill him because it wasn't his time to go yet. Those are the guys that are expressing this attitude. And when they talk about pouring themselves out, they don't mean, hey, I took the time to give you a call on Tuesday. That is not what they're saying. And I love you. But let me stick the knife in just a little bit. How much of ourselves are we pouring out? Where does ministering to others rank on our list of all the stuff we have to do today? We need to consider that. We need to live on purpose and put those things in the correct order. Because it's more important than most of the stuff on my list, and probably yours. Don't be overcome by evil. They're not always going to love you back. Don't be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. And if you're trying to minister to somebody who's lost, now it's tough enough when it's a brother or sister and they don't appreciate it. That's rough. But when you're ministering to somebody who's lost, you've got to expect it. You've got to be shocked if they are not pushing back against you. And you know what? Don't be offended by that. Don't be offended or surprised when lost people sin. It's what they do. It's what we used to do. It's what we still do sometimes. What do? Love them anyway. Why? Because He first loved us. And that while we were yet sinners, He died for us. He poured Himself out. Paul, trying to be like Jesus, is pouring Himself out. If we're going to try to be like Jesus, which is what a real follower does, we've got to be pouring ourselves out. Verse 19, again, do you think that we excuse ourselves to you? We speak before God and Christ, but we do all things, beloved, for your edification. That word excuse, it means defend. Am I saying all this just to defend myself from your attacks? Do I just want you to admit that you're wrong? And that I'm right? No, that is not the point. I don't just want you to follow me, Paul is saying. I want you to follow Jesus, and I'm sharing the truth with you. I'm speaking before God. I am speaking Christ to you. Because that's the right thing to do, because it fulfills the two commandments. Love God by submitting to His command to go and spread the good news and to teach others how to follow Jesus once they're believers. And to love everybody else. This is the only way to edify or build them up. Everything else is actually tearing down what God is trying to build. That's what Paul is saying. He says, guys, I can't apologize for what I'm doing. I hate that there's this contention between us, and I hope this gets straightened out before I get there, because I don't want our meeting to be like that. But I can't change my position. I have no other position to turn to. These false teachers are giving you lies that don't come from Scripture. All I have is Scripture, and that's all I can give you. And I'm not going to apologize for that. Because to do otherwise would do you a disservice. It wouldn't be actually building you up. These other guys, man, they're probably praising you some for your openness and accepting all this sinful behavior and not being judgmental. I can't do that, Paul is saying. And we can't do that. Now, we can't be jerks. We have to love them. Love means you tell them the truth, and then you help them every way you can to accept that truth and to get to where they need to be. You can't just leave them there, and you certainly can't go there with them. Which is something the American church has lost sight of. American church, I don't know if this happens in board meetings or I don't know how this happens, but somewhere the decision over and over gets made, how do we draw a crowd? How do we fill this place up? Can't do it with a hard-line truth. So what do I have to say to get people in? And I'm sure they don't think of it that way in their head, but that's exactly what is happening. And what Paul is saying is, that's tearing people down. I came to build people up, to edify, to exhort. That's what a follower of Christ does. I'm running toward Jesus. Come with me. That's what a follower of Christ does. Verse 24, I fear lest when I come I shall not find you such as I wish, and that I should be found by you such as you do not wish. He said, let's get all these things settled so that when I come I won't have to be at odds with you, and you won't have to be at odds with me, and I can be there joyfully, not mourning the fact that many of you simply aren't going to follow Jesus. But I'm telling you, if you haven't experienced that yet, it's tough to love somebody and to know that you have shared all of the truth that you have with them, and they have chosen to walk a different direction. That leads to a sorrow that I cannot explain to you. And that's what Paul is talking about here. 21, lest when I come again, my God will humble me among you, and I shall mourn for many who have sinned before and have not repented of the uncleanness and the fornication and the lewdness which they practice. It's hard to watch people just jump off a cliff. It's hard to see the world doing that. It's a million times harder to watch somebody you love doing that. And it's a million times harder than that to watch somebody you love who you have been able to share the truth with do that, because they've just rejected it. You see the correlation here to Jesus' message concerning the end times? This is the first time I've ever read this passage and got this. Paul is writing in this letter where he gave them all the warnings. He's writing in the letter, I hope you deal with this because I'm coming. And when I get there, I want us to be joyfully face to face. I never saw that before. But this is the story of Paul. This is the story of how God used him to write most of the New Testament. Paul came to them and he shared the truth with them and he taught them. And then he wrote letters warning them of their missteps. Why? Because he's coming back shortly. And he doesn't want them to find one another on opposite sides of these issues. It's exactly what Jesus did and is doing and will do. He came, he shared the truth, he taught. The Spirit, through men, has written us all of these letters warning us of missteps, convicting us of living, following the flesh instead of the Spirit. And the warning, I'm coming back. The time is short. The day is spent. It won't be long before I'm coming back. We're going to be face to face, and I want that to go well. Please stop living like that. What Jesus does for us. He's saying, deal with those things so that when we're face to face, we can just smile. Go to Matthew 24. Matthew 24, verse Oh, that's the wrong chapter. I was like, that doesn't make any sense. Verse 24, verse 36. Jesus speaking, but of that day and hour no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark, and didn't know until the flood came and took them all away, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Then two men will be in the field, one will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding at the mill, one will be taken and the other left. Watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. That's exactly the attitude and the message of Paul here. For I fear lest when I come, I shall not find you such as I wish. I fear that you're not going to deal with this, and I'm going to have to stand before you in sorrow. That is the message of your Lord to you today. Repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Follow Jesus. Give up the junk, man. This stuff is worthless. Fool's gold. That's all it is. He is coming. And you do not know when. It could happen right now. Would that be a joyful thing for you? In the blink of an eye, to be face-to-face with Jesus. Would you or he be mourning over that? Yet one day, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess, but some of those, that's just acknowledging that the hurricane report was actually true before they are swept away and lost forever. All those people that stayed in their homes, we're not worried about the storm. They say it's coming. We're not worried about it. It's not going to be that big deal. We've made it through a lot of storms. We're not scared. What do you think it's like for those folks when they realize how bad the storm is and they are there all alone and there is nothing else that they can do? At that point, they can do nothing but acknowledge, yes, the storm is that big and it's that scary and it's that dangerous and I was wrong. But it's too late to do anything about it. It's exactly what the end of time will be for us. Chapter 13. This will be the third time I am coming to you. By the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word shall be established. I have told you before and foretell as if I were present the second time. And now being absent, I write to those who have sinned before and to all the rest that if I come again, I will not spare. Since you seek a proof of Christ speaking in me, who is not weak toward you, but mighty in you. For though he was crucified in weakness, yet he lives by the power of God. For we also are weak in him, but we shall live with him by the power of God towards you. Examine yourself as to whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Do you not know yourselves that Jesus Christ is in you? Unless indeed you are disqualified. But I trust that you will know that we are not disqualified. He's saying that they should have considered the mountain of evidence confirming Paul and his team as trustworthy messengers from God. A consistent message over time. No evidence that the message is outside of Christ's teaching. The personal testimony in their own community as to the effect the truth was having in their lives. Mountain of evidence. Again, the congregation should have run the false teachers out of town for the way they attacked Paul, instead of listening to and allowing doubt to get the better of it. When it comes to doctrine that is essential to the Christian faith, there can be no allowing for different ideas or sects within the church. It just can't be. What are the essentials of the Christian faith? Jesus is God. He has the authority and the ability and the desire to forgive the sins of those who confess and repent and place their faith in Him alone for salvation. And that's all that is necessary for somebody to be saved. That is essential Christian doctrine, not Calvary Chapel doctrine, not Baptist doctrine, not Methodist doctrine. That is essential Christian doctrine. If you add anything to that, yes, you have to believe in Jesus and you have to do this, and then you're saved. That is heresy. It is false teaching. It is another gospel of which Paul says there is no other gospel. Everything else, the stuff we talk about on most of the Sunday mornings here, not directly dealing with salvation, but of following Jesus, that's discipleship training. That's a different thing. Learning how to follow Jesus, and occasionally there may be some differences of opinion in those areas. Everything is not spelled out totally in black and white in those areas. That's why Paul, the whole deal with the sacrificed meat, the used meat for sale. Can you buy that in the market? That whole thing. Go back and look at that teaching again. That's what Paul is saying. In the essentials, unity. We all believe the exact same thing. And everything that's not essential, grace. Grace. There are a lot of doctrinal positions out there about discipleship that I disagree with. That does not mean the people sharing that are not saved. I would never attack them as such. But anybody coming with a different gospel, man, I'm all over that. All over that, because that's evil. That's leading people to hell. The problem with the false teachers in Corinth is that they were adding requirements of salvation to the gospel. In essence, they were leading people to a different gospel, which doesn't actually exist. Here's the problem. That's blaspheming everything the Spirit teaches concerning Jesus. See, the Spirit's job is to point people to Jesus. Before you're saved, He's that gut feeling that you're in trouble that's supposed to make you seek the truth, and then He will give you the truth that you need Jesus. For the believer, that's you have the indwelling of the Spirit, and he's the one that then gives you the conviction, hey, that you're not following Jesus when you did that, when you said that, when you thought that. You need to work on that. I'm going to help you. I'm going to give you the strength, but you have to decide to work on that. Pointing people to Jesus and to the gospel is all He does. And to accept a different gospel than what He has shared with you through somebody else, that's blaspheming the Holy Spirit, which is what Scripture says is the unpardonable sin. Not a unpardonable sin. The unpardonable sin. You cannot believe a different gospel and go to heaven. I'm sorry, all roads do not lead to heaven. You're not going to make any friends saying that. But it's the truth. And you got to point that out for people, or else you don't actually love them. That's why Paul is so passionate about this. There's a real and present danger, and it needs to be addressed. So here's the question. Does it need to be addressed in your life? This is 2,000 years ago. These guys had a problem. But here's the problem for us. We've already talked about how this society at Corinth very closely resembles our modern-day society here in this country. They were very fleshly. They were very affluent. There was a lot of idol worship around that they had access to and that affected them and their families. They were in constant contact with all of those things. And they had to choose constantly to live separate from those beliefs and those traps in order to follow Jesus. And that's exactly who you guys are. That is the position you are in. Examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. He's not saying, I don't think any of you guys are saved. He's saying, I see some troubling things going on inside that church. We could say inside our country. And since you're a part of that, I'm asking you to examine yourself and make sure you are in the faith. That doesn't mean, Paul is not saying, that means you have to agree with every single thing I ever say, and if you don't, you're out. He's saying, man, the essentials of the Christian doctrine of salvation. Examine yourself and make sure you are in the faith. This is why I'm always pushing you guys. And most of you, some of you may not see this all the time. Sometimes we do this very openly and publicly. But I'm always asking people, man, share the gospel with me. Explain the gospel to me. I've said that to most of you in this room. Why do I do that? It's not to put you on the spot or make you uncomfortable. I want to know that you know the gospel. Because if you don't, you're me at about 21 or 22 years old. When I realized, wait a minute, I don't even understand what this means. I've been calling myself a Christian for 10 years. I can't even explain the gospel to somebody. So that's a hot button issue for me. I'm very sensitive to the fact that there are a lot of people sitting in churches that have the stickers on their car and they have their Bible and they come to church. But they can't share the gospel with somebody, not because they don't have the social skills to do that, because they don't have the facts to share. Which, consider your way. Examine yourself. If that is you, man, let's deal with that today. Don't leave this place today. Come and ask me whatever questions you have. I want to make sure that you know the God, if nothing else, the gospel, so that you can make a real decision as to whether you want to follow it or not. So that you can be assured that you are not disqualified. That scares me to death. Teaching the Bible to somebody that thinks they're saved and they're not, man, it gives me nightmares. I want you guys to be the best fed sheep in the world. Whatever God teaches me, I want to turn around and teach it right to you. But biblical knowledge will not save you. The gospel is the only thing that will save you. And I want to make sure you have that. Verse 7. Now I pray to God that you do no evil. Not that we should appear approved, but that you should do what is honorable, though we may seem disqualified. For we can do nothing against the truth, but for the truth. For we are glad when we are weak and you are strong. And this also we pray that you may be made complete. Therefore I write these things, being absent, lest being present I should use sharpness, according to the authority which the Lord has given me for edification and not for destruction. Finally, brethren, farewell. Become complete. Be of good comfort. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Verse 7 is the deal. Now I pray to God that you do no evil. Not that we should appear approved. Not so that we will be shown as right. But that you should do what is honorable. Even if you think we're idiots, even if you think we're jerks, even if you think we're wrong, we just want you to do right. We just want you to follow Jesus. It's why Paul does everything he does. It's why I do what I do. And hopefully it's why you do what you do in your home and in your job and in your community, anywhere that you have a forum to touch other people's lives. Let people think what they want about us, so long as we share the truth in love. That is all that matters. We can't be willing to change the message in order to make people feel more comfortable where they are. That's not showing real love. We have to draw lines that we aren't willing to cross. If the truth is what actually sets people free, then what kind of friend am I if I allow you to wander from the truth without saying anything? I know you're going to get accused of being a jerk. I know that. Be willing to take that lump for the cause is what I'm asking you to do. You make sure you share the truth. You make sure that you do it in love with a heart of restoration. And just take whatever it is that you get back for. Love, hate, honor, dishonor. They can call you crazy. You can call me crazy all you want. Too many professing believers today treat discipleship like a game of tag. Get get away from home base, which is the truth. Get away from home base and wander around hoping not to get caught before you get back. That is not discipleship. That is not repentance. That is not following Jesus at all. At all. Verse 11. Finally, brethren, farewell. Become complete. Be of good comfort. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. This is edification. This is exhortation. This is Paul's real talent, his real gift from God is being able to say, man, you guys know what the truth is. Just do that. And if you do, you're not just going to have the peace of knowing that your conscience is clear, that you did right. The God of love and peace will be with you. And that's the whole point of all these harsh things that I had to say to you guys. Remember, it was Paul that said, you can use all the gifts that you want. If it's not done in love, and it's like a clanging cymbal. He is no clanging cymbal. He's not just wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong. It's like, man, guys, this is wrong. This is dangerous. Get as close as you can to God because that's going to be awesome for you. You're going to be so much happier there than you are here. Share the truth in love. What's the truth? You're messed up. You are messed up. That's the truth. What's the love? One of God's specialties is fixing broken people. He takes chaos and He puts it in order. That's how it works. Paul says here to be complete. In the Greek, man, that word, it means to be perfect. Wow. Paul's like, okay, to sum up, be perfect. Yikes. Is that possible? And yet, Paul says, be complete, which means be perfect. James says to count it all joy when you fall into various trials and temptations. He talks about, man, that's leading you to completeness, perfection. What did Jesus say to that woman? Go and sin no more. Is that possible? Jesus and Paul and James being pretty blunt here and saying, hey, don't sin anymore. Don't play around the edges. This is the real deal. This is Jesus. This is the Lord of all creation you say you're giving your life to. Quit doing what your flesh wants to do. Paul, in explaining grace in another book, he says, yeah, man, this grace is awesome, and it covers all sin, and it takes care of all of that, and it gives you the strength to overcome. And he says, because grace is so magnificent, to make it even more bigger, do we sin more? So that there can be more grace, so that we can praise God for all the grace, so we sin a little more, so He can forgive us for that, so we can tell people how great He is? He said, no. Absolutely not. He actually says, how can we continue in sin who have given our life to Jesus, who have accepted this gift of grace, which we did not earn, which we do not deserve? This redemption from the pits of hell that He's given us, are we to take that and then just be, oh, thanks. Whew. Now I can do what I want to do and not have to worry about it anymore. That's why Paul says, be complete. Be perfect. Set a goal of perfection. See, our problem is we set a goal of a little better. If I had a nickel for every time that I have gone to somebody with a concern, hey, I'm worried about you because I see this, or I see this, or I see this, and they go, yeah, I need to do a little better. Don't let a little better be your goal. Let perfection be the goal, and then do as much better as you can. How much better can we do? Scripture says that there is no temptation ever that we're presented with that is stronger than the Holy Spirit in us. It says there's no temptation ever that we're going to be faced with where God hasn't provided a way out if we want the way out. Is it possible to never sin again? It is. Should that be the goal? Yes. By the power of the Holy Spirit, it is possible, and it should be the goal. Are we sometimes just going to have a bad day, and we're lazy, and we're not paying attention, and we revert back to the flesh? Paul says, yeah, man, I find it a law that, man, the inward man, he wants to serve God, and the flesh wants to serve the flesh, and there's a war going on. Are we going to lose some of those battles? Yeah, but don't ever be content in that. Don't ever just expect that. Expect better of yourself. Not because you're strong or you're special or you're going to work harder. No. Because you have the same Holy Spirit in you that Jesus had in him when he was here, that Paul has in him writing these letters and ministering to people. It is possible to overcome evil. So let's shoot for that. This is what a good parent does. They when they're trying to teach their kid how to walk or something, what do? They model walking before them. Hey, check this out. This is cool. Look. The kid's like, wow, that's cool. I don't even know how to get started. So what does the parent do? You grab them by their little hands and you hold them up and you teach them how to balance. And then once they finally take a step or two, what do? Don't you stand two steps away? And then when they start towards you, don't you back up just a little bit? Don't you keep setting the goal farther away? And don't they keep going after it? Yeah. That's the way discipleship works. Jesus says the goal is way over here. Paul says the goal is way over here. That's why Paul talks about our life of discipleship as running a race. Run your race with conviction. Lay aside all the weight that's slowing you down. Train. Don't get distracted. Keep your eye on the goal. The goal is way over there. And when you fall on the way, get back up and take off again. Don't be content where you fell. Kids don't do that. And if you're a baby Christian, you're just getting started in this, and you see some other people around, you're like, man, I can't imagine ever doing that. Man, they know all of this stuff, and they've memorized all this scripture, and they do all these things, and they have this attitude. I don't even know how to get that far. That's the goal. That's way over there. You just get started. A parent teaches you how to walk, and then you see somebody running, and you're like, running? That looks cool. And you start working on that. Then you see somebody riding a bike, and you're like, riding a bike. You just keep learning stuff that builds on what you just learned. Before you can ride a bike or walk or run or skip or jump, you got to learn how to balance. You can't do that on you. You need help. You need somebody to hold your hand. That's what the Holy Spirit in us does. He provides the knowledge, the strength, the ability right where we are to do what we need to do that day. And then he just keeps introducing new skills and new abilities along the way. If we are pushing toward the goal, if we choose to stand still, he's just like, okay, let me know when we're going to get started again. There's a conviction there. Hey, you need to get started again. Hey, you need to get started again. Hey, you need to get started again. But he never makes us go. It's not how it works. Here's what I think may be one of the bigger points of these books that we just studied, 1 and 2 Corinthians. We named the series The Increase because Paul's thing was, hey, some of you guys are following specific teachers and all that. You need to drop all of that. This is about following Jesus. And some of us are allowed to plant seed. And some of us are allowed to water the seed of truth in you. And some of us provide the fertilizer for the, you know, whatever. We all have a part to play in everybody else's life. But the increase, the actual growth, that comes straight from God. Nobody else can give you that. Don't follow anybody else. You follow Jesus. And so we, because we're dealing with the flesh, what we end up believing are these lies of the enemy that okay, even believers will think this way. Okay, well, yeah, God is my power source. But you know what? This thing that I really like, that I know he's not crazy about, but that helps me relax, or that helps me deal with things. Or, you know, whatever it is, I don't care what it is. That helps me in some way. So I'm going to add that to my thing. I'm going to keep that. Yeah, Jesus, yes, but I need a little bit of that. And then I like this thing, I'm going to add a little bit of that. And then even the good stuff. Okay, here are the good works that I'm going to do. Yeah, I'm going to add that. That gives me strength. And the worship, we were talking about the worship earlier. Yeah, that helps me. So I'm going to add that. And then, oh, there's that sin. I need just a little bit of that. And we take all this stuff and we connect it all together. See, I'm a truck driver. So in my semi, I have 4 humongous batteries, because that's the kind of power it takes to turn over this big, huge engine that's in the truck, right? All those batteries have 12 volts of power. And so when you add them all together, you don't get 48 volts of power. You get a whole lot of 12-volt power. And that's what it takes. That's the way it works. You call that daisy chaining those batteries together, just to get more of the same power. The lie that we tend to believe is, every time I add something to this plan that I have of how I'm going to make it through today, we act like we're adding more power to the chain. Everything that we need comes from God. He is the increase. Everything else we do is an act of obedience and faith and worship, and that's to glorify Him. But He has to be the source. And see, here's the other thing about driving a truck. When you have one of the batteries go bad, it's not just that you have less 12-volt power. You have less 12-volt power, and you have one battery that's actually draining that. So you don't even have 12 volts in all of these. See what I'm saying? It's not just they're not helping. It's actually draining the other batteries, because it's sucking up energy as fast as it can. And you know what? Most days, it's not a big deal. Most days, those other 3 batteries, plenty of power. Start the truck, make it through the day. They're getting charged because they're connected to the engine. And so during the day, they're getting charged and they make it. Man, by the end of the day, you can't even tell that you got a little bit less power. Next morning, you can tell it's there, but it still starts and it goes on. Here's the problem. You can go on like that for a long time without replacing that battery, without kicking it, without even unconnecting it. You can survive for a long time like that until that day when it's 12 degrees. That day when you actually need all of that power that's provided by the 4 batteries and you don't have all of it, click, click, click. You know what a jump start for a semi cost? Oh, Lordy. And you're thinking back, man, I knew that battery was going bad. I should have replaced it. Should have replaced it. Now I don't have the energy to get started. Life is like that. You can cruise along for a while. You know, on a normal day, maybe God's power plus the couple of things that you're hanging on to that are a little bit of a drain, it's not enough of a drain to keep you from moving forward most days. But that one day when everything piles up, you just can't handle it. You can't move on. You're dead in the water. You need a jump start. How does the jump start come? Other believers. God places it in their heart, give you a call. Hey, you doing okay today? Man, you're on my mind. Are you all right? Can I pray with you? Pick up the Bible and read some scripture, man. You're charging. You're charging the batteries when you do that. Sing some of those worship songs with the right heart, praising God in your trouble. That's charging the batteries. You can get a jump start. He can get you going. The batteries aren't charged yet, but man, when they jump start the semi, they bring this machine down there, and man, they can flip the switch and turn it over to 24 volts. And shoot all of that in there at once, and it's like, Now, we can't handle that all the time either, okay? But that's what it can be like when people come alongside you and help out. It's kind of like a proximity charger. You know, those chargers they have now where you just get your phone close to it and it charges it. But then you take it away, what happens? It starts draining again. See, we can be that for one another. We can be proximity chargers for one another. A tool that God uses to help somebody get through that day when they're just too weak. But you got to address the problem. The problem is you've got dead weight in the chain. And you've got to ditch it. This church at Corinth, man, they wanted Jesus, but when these false teachers came in adding something to it, it's like, okay, yeah, we better have that too. Let's add that to the chain. And we like our fornication and our adultery. We really like that, so we're going to add that to the chain. And then they just kept adding stuff in and piling it on. And that's dangerous. That's dangerous. So don't do that. Disconnect all the dead weight. Disconnect it. Get away from it. Spend as much time as you can next to the proximity chargers. That's like a little maintenance charge during the day. Man, hang out with believers. Hang out with the Word. Hang out with God in prayer. That's where you really get charged up. And you can't accomplish that, but you can desire it. And if you desire it, He will give it to you. Anybody have a testimony otherwise? Have you ever actually wanted God and He turned His back on you? That's what I thought. Father, we come before You today in the name of Your precious Son, Christ Jesus, and we ask for every blessing available. We ask You to be the power source in our life. We ask You to be the leading, guiding factor in every decision that we make, every word that we say. Lord, we want to put all of our faith and trust in You for salvation, for discipleship, for ministry, for everything it is that You have for us. We want it to be of You and by You and for You alone. We don't want to take any credit for it. We don't want to brag about things for ourselves as though we accomplished something. We want to be like Paul. We want You to fill us with Your Holy Spirit to overflowing so that we infect and affect the world around us, bringing them to You. And when it gets difficult and we have to share difficult things with people, letting them know that we see trouble in their life, Lord, give us the wisdom and the discernment to allow You to lead in that instance, to give us the words and the tone of voice and the body language to go along with that so that it can be received in a healthy way. Because it's never about degrading someone or pushing them down. It's about holding out a hand to lift them up. Let us be that help. Lord, with all meekness and humility, with no trust in ourselves, we come before You today just asking for You to be our God. That we would be Your people, that we would follow You no matter what. We desire to be loved. As humans, we love to be loved. That's why Your love resonates with us so powerfully. And we also want that from our spouses and our kids and our friends and our neighbors and our coworkers. We feel like that's an energy source for us. But at best, it's only a temporary little jolt. Our power has to come from You. And when we see somebody else in trouble, we have to share that truth with them. Give us the ability to do that the way You would have it done, with the heart of Paul. Yeah. Just use us. Let us be vessels for You to spread Your love and grace and mercy and truth through. Allow us to be so steadfast in the truth that everybody knows where our lines, where our barriers are. And yet, just like Jesus when He was here, Lord, let them accept us so that we have access to them. Let us be able to present ourselves in such a way that we can say offensive things without being offensive. That's an impossibility for humans. And yet, it's right up your alley. It's exactly what You do. Lord, You have all of the tact needed to share the truth in love with everybody. And I just pray that lives are changed through this church, through Your people. I pray that You'd let it start right here. Let a mighty revival start in us right here, right now. That we would just yield to You totally. We would unhook every other power source from our life and just depend on You. Have Your way in us. May Your will be done. It's in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Love y'all.